In this video, we are going to take a look at several ways that we can add dimensional constraints to a sketch. As you know by now, if you are sketching an object and you type in a value as you are drawing, Autodesk Inventor is going to automatically apply a dimensional constraint to it. If you draw without typing in a value though, the lines are drawn but no dimensional constraints are added. We can come back after the fact and add our own dimensional constraints. Because of this, it's often easier to just go ahead and draw a rough version of the shape and then add dimensions to it after the fact. So let's take a look at a few dimensional tools. We just have one dimension tool here, but it covers all types of dimensions. It just depends on what types of objects you click on. So first of all, if I click on a single line, I'll be able to click to place the dimension there. Now notice how my Edit Dimension dialog box pops up right away. That is a setting in the right-click menu. So while the dimension tool is active, I can right-click and see that Edit Dimension is turned on. It's typically on by default. If it's not on your computer, you're going to want to turn that on so that you can edit dimensions as you place them. So since mine is on, I'm just going to escape out of this menu here. So as I place this 2-inch dimension by clicking on line, you can also dimension by clicking to parallel lines, because the length of this line is also the same as the length between these two parallel lines here. You can also dimension linearly between points. So if I have a couple of circles and I want to dimension between their center points to keep them a certain distance apart, you can see that we can do that as well. I can also dimension between different types of objects. So maybe the center of this circle needs to be 10 inches away from this line. I can add that dimension as well. You can use these same dimension tools to dimension the radius or diameter of an arc or a circle. If I select a circle, I'm automatically going to be given the diameter dimension, since that's typically the way circles are dimensioned. If I really wanted to specify the radius before placing the dimension, I can right-click, go to dimension type, and switch it to radius. Again, this is actually contrary to standard dimensions, but you do have the ability to switch. If I have an arc, then by default, again, similar to standards, it's going to give me the radius value, not the diameter. I can right-click and adjust that just like I did on the circle. But again, typically you're going to see the radius for an arc and the diameter for a circle. Also notice the difference between the symbols. The diameter is going all the way across. The radius will just point to the arc itself. We can use the same tool to measure an angle. So here I can come in with the dimension tool, pick two lines, then click to place the angle between them. And then of course I can go ahead and type in the desired value to constrain it. You can also dimension tangent values as well. So for example, let's say that I have a couple of circles here with a diameter of 2. I'm going to create a horizontal relationship between their center points. And when I dimension the circles, if I click one circle, it tries to give me the diameter. If I click the other, then it's going to give me the dimension between their centers, which is great if that's what I wanted. But instead, I want to dimension to their tangencies. So I'm going to click on the one circle, then come over to the other one. And as I move around, I'll see the tangent symbol here. I'll go ahead and click to place that. And now you can see that I'm actually dimensioning to the tangencies of these circles instead. I can also do that if I'm dimensioning off of a line. So I'm going to dimension off of this line, and instead of going to the center of this shape, I want to go to its tangency. I'll just move my mouse until I see the symbol, then I can click to place it. Similar to how I can click to switch to the tangent, I can also do the same thing with an aligned dimension. So if I come back up to this angled line and I dimension it, if I select the line, by default I'm going to get a linear dimension. I can dimension either the horizontal or vertical distance depending on where I move my mouse and click. But as I get closer to the line, I'll see the little symbol next to my mouse for an aligned dimension. All I will do is click here in space when I see that symbol, and you can see that it's switched to an aligned dimension. So now I can actually dimension the length of that line, not just the horizontal and vertical values. If you're going to create a revolved feature, it's really convenient to use the center line tool. So let's create a little example shape here. And then I will draw a line right in the middle. This is going to be the center that it revolves around. I'm going to select this center line, and then here in the format panel, I'm actually going to turn it into a center line. The benefit of doing this is how my dimensions appear. I'm going to undo and just show you that when it was a regular line, if I dimension between here and the shape itself, I get a linear dimension. But as soon as I turn this into a center line, Inventor recognizes what I'm trying to do. And so when I come in with a dimension between this line and the center line, it's going to give me a diameter value. If I'm working with a revolve, most likely I know the diameter value. So now I don't have to do the math to figure out what the radius value is going to be in each situation. It's going to automatically give me diameter dimensions. I'm going to erase all of my geometry here and start with a blank screen. And what I want to look at next is the idea of over-dimensioning or over-constraining a sketch. Inventor will not let you over-dimension. So for example, very simple example, if I created a rectangle, I'll start at the origin point here. And if I come in and maybe add a 10-inch dimension to this side and a 5-inch dimension to this side, if I come and try to dimension the left side of the part, it's not going to let me. It's letting me know that this is going to over-constrain the sketch. If I've already locked in the 5 inches over here, and we have horizontal constraints, then this left side has to be 5 inches. There's no need to dimension it. And because, as we know, Inventor is dimension-driven, it's only going to give me one dimension to drive the model. So when you see this message, you can either cancel to stop what you're doing, or you can click accept to create a driven dimension. A driven dimension is one that's in parentheses. It is not one that you can use to edit the model. If I double click on it, you can see it is grayed out. I cannot edit it. So it's basically just a reporting dimension. I can still edit the original dimension, and you can see that one will update. The last thing I want to point out is down here in your status bar, the little text down here that says fully constrained. When you're sketching, you want to watch that, because every sketch that you make, you want to be fully constrained. Fully constrained means that it's not going to move in some way that we don't expect. So, for example, once again, I will start from scratch here. I'll draw a rectangle out in space. I'll go ahead and add a couple of dimensions on it. Maybe it will be 5 by 3. And while I have the size of the rectangle locked down, I don't have its location locked down. That's why these lines are still green. Now, you might be using a different color scheme, so you will see different colors. In my particular color scheme, lines are green when they're under constrained and black when they're fully constrained. So while the box itself is the correct size, if I click and drag on any line, I can see it's free to move about in space. And you can see down below, it still needs two dimensions. So it basically needs to be locked in horizontally and vertically. Now keep in mind, while it says dimensions, it really means overall constraints. So I can fix this either by adding dimensional constraints or geometric constraints. So in this case, I might want the corner of the box to touch the origin. I'll use the coincident constraint, choose the corner and the origin. As you can see, it changes color now, and you can see the status bar says fully constrained. Again, this is the goal. Every time we sketch something, we want it to be fully constrained. That way later when we maybe add it to an assembly and create some relationships between features, we want to make sure that nothing happens unexpectedly. That concludes this look at dimensional sketch constraints in Autodesk Inventor.